years ago, who can say when, Les Îles des Chausey, like all the Channel Islands, were a group of hills lying on a vast plain that stretched out into the Atlantic past Ireland. The movement of the Earth's crust and erosion have left the islands high and sometimes dry in the corner formed by Normandy and the north coast of Brittany. The sea surging into that corner, the Bay of Mont Saint-Michel, produces a tidal rise and fall of over 40 feet on spring tides, one of the highest in the world. The clock has little influence on the people of Chausey. Life is lived according to dawn, dusk, the weather, and tides. It's said, although no one can quote the source, that when the tide is in, the archipelago has one island for each week of the year. At low tide, there's an island for every day of the year. Man has passed this way for tens of thousands of years, either on foot before the sea took over, then in dugout canoes, and now families pour in on the daily ferries or their own private yachts. Victor Hugo described the Channel Islands as fragments of Europe dropped by France and picked up by England. The fragments of Chausey appear to have been picked up by England in the Middle Ages when the Channel Islands, including Chausey, were transferred from the Diocese of Coutances to Winchester, a papal bull that was ignored by Channel Islanders for centuries. Jersey lies 28 miles north of here, and its inhabitants laid claim to Chausey's natural resources for hundreds of years. In the 13th century, Jerseymen harvested wrack, seaweed, for manure. In 1744, Jersey privateers captured and occupied Chausey for a few years. And early last century, fishermen from Goree in Jersey poached from the local oyster beds. The French hadn't bothered with occasional visits from Jersey boats. When English companies began sending large fleets, there was trouble. The Sunday Times in 1828 reported an unpleasant affair between English fishers and French vessels of war in which several lives were lost. That trouble is forgotten now, and it would be difficult not to find a Jersey or Guernsey yacht moored in Chausey Sound, and its crew in one of the bars, possibly discussing their common Norman heritage with a local fisherman. They're a friendly bunch, unless you associate them with Brittany. They are fervently proud of coming from Norman stock. The last sovereignty dispute between France and Jersey was over the Minkes, a group of rocks which before the invasion of the sea formed part of the same range of hills as Chausey. The cluster of small granite houses on Maitres Isle, the one habitable island of the Minkes, were built by people from Jersey. Chausey Islanders had fished the reef for years, and in 1939 a party of them set off in 15 boats in a half-serious, half-in-fun expedition to put up a prefabricated house to claim the Minkes under an ancient law. But then came World War II and the German occupation. Finally, in the early 50s, the International Court of Justice at The Hague gave sovereignty to Britain, where British and French fishermen have equal rights in the fishing grounds. Jerseymen make regular trips to the Minkes for business and pleasure, and occasionally to ensure there's somewhere for the flag to fly, just to remind the world of the reef's ownership. The jagged rocks of the Minkes are notorious among navigators, and Chausey has gathered his fair share of wrecks. The reefs of Chausey may have been an embarrassment to sailors and given much bounty to wreckers, an infamous occupation in the Channel Islands some years ago. But over the centuries, the rocks also provided a living for locals and imported labour until fairly modern times. The foundations of the islands are a very hard, durable and distinctively coloured granite.
This is one of the larger of Chausey's quarries. Many more are dotted all over these islands here. And Chausey granite can be found at Mont Saint-Michel, streets of Paris, streets of London. And after the war, this quarry was reopened to rebuild Saint-Malo.
Most of the old town of Saint-Malo was devastated during the Second World War. Its restoration is an amazing tribute to the skill of the craftsmen involved. Quarrying on Chausey was a thriving industry back in the 14th century. In 1850, 300 quarries were counted on the islets of the archipelago. But 50 years later, the trade was almost dead as concrete came more into use. Local granite was used in building Le Vieux Fort, better known as Chateau Renaud. It dominates the east coast of Grande Île, the only island of the group now inhabited. The chateau is not as ancient as it first appears. The name is the clue. It was built on the site of an old fort in the early 20s for Louis Renault, the motor car manufacturer. The stern exterior gives no hint of its elegant rooms. Louis Renault had several houses in France, but he spent much time here, resting and thinking about the next model to be produced in his factories. The chateau was sold by the Renault family in the mid-70s, and is now owned by Pierre Henriet, who is involved in today's boom industry, electronics. The Henriet family is one of three who own most of Chausey. Privately owned it may be, but few areas on the main island are fenced off from the public. The elder statesman of Chausey is a figure familiar to thousands of lovers of the sea. Marin Marie, one of the island's landowners, is a world-renowned marine artist and sailor. He was the man who led that party to the Minkies in 1939. At 81, he's still as vigorous as the sea has loved and respected all his life. His restless passion was the spur which sent him, as an ordinary seaman, to the Arctic on two Shackleton expeditions 60 years ago. Journeys on which Marin Marie combined his wanderlust and artistry. He didn't join Shackleton's next voyage, which ended in disaster. The vessel sank off Iceland. Marin Marie is also part of sailing folklore. In 1933, he sailed single-handed from France to America in Winnebel, an 11-meter gaff rig cutter, and came back again single-handed in the motorboat Ariel, a 13-meter craft with a top speed around 8 knots. Marin Marie was the first man to complete that daring double alone.
Single-handed passages are not so very few as people think, from west to east, because of course the tide is more favorable from Canada or Newfoundland, the coast of, and just like this for the airplanes who first flew the Atlantic, that way, let's say America to Europe. And one Frenchman, Gerbeau, with an English yacht, the Farcrest, first attempted the passage single-handed the other way. And from the Mediterranean to New York, via the trade route. But he was very long. He was 101 days. That made a speed of 1.5 knots, not very satisfactory. And of course he had any amount of trouble with his sails. But I was a second, because I found it was a very poor performance. I sailed from Brittany to the West Indies and up with the tide to New York. It was not a very quick passage, but it gained a month. On Gerbeau, on a much longer route, because of course from Whitney I had to go down first through latitude of Madeira. I had a very good little ship that still exists, and she's now in some others, I told you. Yes. And the second time was quite a different thing. I wanted to make an experience with diesel-powered craft. When people used to be very much afraid of the ability of motor crafts, and often, and nowadays still, had several engines, double, triple engines, just for security. I found it was quite a stupid affair, I thought. I never liked twin engines, twin troubles.
That experience in sailing, plus his life on Chausey, in and around boats every day, has given Marie quite definite ideas on his art.
I believe, by the way, that painting a ship is a matter that cannot be made with too much fantasy. A ship is a ship, and it's an organized ship, and a ship has a face, and a ship has an entité, we call it, that cannot be touched.
Do you actually enjoy the job of painting, or are you a perfectionist and are never satisfied?
Oh, yes, of course. I may say that I enjoy painting, even landscapes and people and portraits and whatnot. It's I do not understand people who paint only one kind of thing all their life. And I enjoy painting anything at all, except that I'm not very good at decoration. I'm not a decorator made when, for instance, Picasso is. I knew Picasso quite well. I used to have lunch every day with him at one time, and we did understand each other quite well.
If you say you knew Picasso, I've always had a feeling that Picasso was having a huge joke by painting some of the things he painted. Do you feel that about him when you met him? Did you feel as though he was a practical joker in the way he painted?
Well, he said what. Well, very often, and wrote itself, so we have documents about it, that he wasn't quite serious about himself. He said, well, people want this kind of thing, well, I do it. When I did paint everybody, I couldn't sell my work. But he said, and said more than once to me.
Marie and his wife Germaine now spend the winter in Normandy, but they always return to Chausey for the rest of the year, where they are joined on special occasions by their family. 4 years, Chausey has been second home for many families from the French mainland. Nolly Hervé still comes back to the islands of her childhood memories.
I never came to this island. I was brought to this island when I was a few months old. My grandfather built this house. And so I came with my parents as a very young child. And ever since afterwards, we came back repetitively every summer. At first only for a few weeks because the house was very uncomfortable, and later on when they added up to the house, it became our summer house. By the time I was 15 years old, I started to come on my own, and to me it meant freedom, especially since I lived in Paris. It was like a totally different world. The community is especially fascinating. We all grew up together. We've known each other ever since we were born. So there are various families. We know everybody. We've done all kind of mischief together. And it created a link between us and made it a very special world to all of us. So after my children were born, they came here when they were also very young. My son was 2 months old, my daughter was 2 weeks old, and they're going to grow up on this island with their cousins and friends, and it's the same story that's going to repeat itself all over again. The island itself, it's a wilderness. The fact that there are no cars, no bicycles, as I said before, total freedom. It's some kind of a special place because we can, all we've got to do is hop on a boat and go among the other islands, and there's never any strain put on us. We never felt any danger on this island. As a matter of fact, nothing bad ever happened. So not only we felt freedom, but we felt confidence in the place. It's also extraordinarily beautiful. The light changes all the time. The landscape changes all the time with the tides. So watching, you can actually sit in the garden or walk around the island, and you'll get a different vision of the place, like every hour. And this is something irreplaceable. And I've been in many places around the world, and I don't think I've ever found such a beautiful place. Obviously, I'm in love with the island. And this is also where I have my roots. And roots are very important to me. They're important to me, and I feel they're important for my children, just like they were to my forebears.
The main catch in these waters is buque, a small prawn. But the fishermen will take anything that's edible for market, or not so tasty for bait. Each of the crews have their own favorite and often secret fishing spots, and there's great friendly rivalry when the catch comes in.
Ça fait 8 et demi, hein?
Oui. Ça fait loin.
Although the tourists bring life and money to Chausey, the fishermen provide continuity. Some of the catch helps feed the tourists. Most of it goes to market in Granville, 10 miles away on the Normandy coast, where most of the fishermen spend their winters. The islands came under the administration of Granville in 1802. During the summer holidays, the fishermen bring their families back to Chausey, where the youngsters have a ready-made adventure playground in the new fort. The fort was built last century, and apart from holding 300 German prisoners during the First World War, has never been used in anger. The only ferries to the islands leave from Granville, as they have done since the beginning of this century. Today's ferries still bring tourists by the hundred on day trips. At the height of the season during school holidays, a couple of bars and restaurants are fully stretched to cope with demand. And there is a small hotel for longer-stay guests. Does the comparatively short season make it difficult to earn a living? Hotelier Bernard Pichard.
No, the problem is not to earn money. The problem is not to spend it. And during the winter in Chausey, you don't spend it. So you just enjoy your time. And during the when I earn enough money to go to the West Indies, 2 months during the bad season, January and February, where I got more sunshine than here.
Do you think that with regard to tourism, that there are too many people coming in too short a time?
Yes, I would prefer that in May and June there will be more people, because in August there are really too many people coming in August. But out side of August, we could get more people. But otherwise, it's all right, no problem.
The islands are far from self-sufficient. The lighthouse, apart from its duty as nightly sentinel, generates electricity. There is a small farm, but its main product is beef cattle for export to the mainland. Chausey has no fresh water. Each house has to store its own, and in summer, water is brought from Granville. Every commodity except fish is bought on the daily ferries or on board La Move, an 8-meter gaff rig cutter. From the jetty, there is a small modern aid to the daily humping of cargo, an old Jersey milk marketing board float. La Mauve is owned by Gilbert Hurel, one of the few islanders who live on Chausey the year round.
I love living in small communities, otherwise I wouldn't be here. In the summer, in the heart of the summer like now, it is a bit overpopulated here. Too many tourists coming for the day, up to 1,000 a day sometimes with the ferries. Well, they only arrive in the morning and leave in the evening, but it's a lot of people for such a small island. The rest of the year it's all right, you know. Well, I would say in the winter it's the contrary. Not enough people. Sometimes we're just 8, 10 people living on the island. Then you feel really very lonesome sometimes, very deserted, you know.
Do you get many tourists come over here and see the island and then have this dream of living here, come over and then very soon leave?
Daydreamers, we've got plenty of them, yeah, but nobody comes back in the winter. No problem. So many people have told me that, you know, it must be such a fantastic life. Well, come and work with me, I've got plenty of work, you know. After November, you don't see one bloke.
I know you're involved in the conservation of the island. You've been doing some work on that. Can you tell me about that?
Yeah, well, the problem on such a small island with so many visitors is that they tend to ruin the place, even without wanting to ruin. You know, they're just too numerous. So the dunes, the sand, etc., you know, tends to, disintegrate. Too many people walking, so the owners of the island have very privately tried to put some money in the island to protect the land, you know, put some fences. Well, you've seen these fences when we've been walking around, so that all the grass doesn't die, that the sand dunes don't eat all the island. In the place, you've seen this place where it's very narrow. They had to put posts and wires and replant inside these wires. A few years ago, if they hadn't do this, the island would have been cut in two, most probably, because the grass doesn't hold and the bushes doesn't hold the sand anymore because of too many people walking. So they did a huge work, you know, of maintenance in the islands.
Looking to the future, you've got this problem that of being very seasonal with only a few people here in the winter.
Mm-hmm.
Can you see any way of reviving the life of the island during the winter?
Well, that's one of the daydreams. The only way. Well, one important thing would be to reopen the school. Because some people, especially amongst the fishermen, would still be staying all year round in Chausey if there was a school opened for the kids. But when the school was closed, was I think about 10 years ago, not very long ago, for purely, well, technical or administrative reasons, not enough pupils, only there were 8 or 9 of them, you know. Well, the few families that were left just vanished back to Granville. They had to because of the school. So if the school was reopened, but there is nothing we can do about it, you know, it's, the states probably could do something about it, but I don't think they care very much. That would be a good way of bringing life back to the islands in the winter. But you've got to do to start the coming back, you know. If there were a few people to come back in the winter, there would probably be more ferries because there would be more passengers to transport. But now we are really in the hollow of the recession. But I think, well, we do hope to be a bit more numerous next winter. That would be great because living here in the winter is fantastic, as long as you're not totally alone.
Nowhere is perfect, of course, and it's doubtful if human beings, with all their imperfections, would feel comfortable anywhere that was. But for island lovers, Chausey comes close, and even at the height of summer, it's still possible to find a place all to yourself.